Welcome to Teaching the Truth with Pastor Eric C. Bogan.
Clearly define what I am to do. Let every word penetrate the heart. Let what is said lead them running to your arm. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord.
I want to share with you out of the book of Matthew, chapter 12. So turn over there. Now, I'm just warning you in advance. I'm here to warn you in advance. You haven't been here in a while. And I'm just warning you in advance. This particular sermon, it's a mama sermon, kinda. But it's got a little twist in it. Yeah. If you've been to the club before, you know what a little twist. Put a little twist on there. If you don't, you've never been to a club, but don't worry about it. Amen. So this one's got a little twist to it. Amen. But I've entitled this message, Who is My Mother? I was gonna get ethnic on y'all and say, Who is my mama? But you know, I wanted to keep it sophisticated. Who is my mother? I know who my mother is. Well, okay. Matthew chapter 12, verse 46. And it reads, While he yet talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brethren stood without, desiring to speak with him. The him here is Jesus. Verse 47. Then one said to him, Behold, your mother and your brethren stand without, desiring to speak with you. But he answered, that is, Jesus answered and said unto him that told him, Who is my mother? Who are my brethren? And he stretched forth his hands toward his disciples and said, Behold, my mother, my brethren, for whosoever, are you listening? Whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother, my sister, my mother. Now you can see where I got the title. It was Jesus who asked the question, Who is my mother? And it was the same Jesus who answered his own question by saying, My mother is whoever does the will of my Father. Somebody say, oh my. Oh my, Jesus. Shocking. Shocking words from our Lord. Well, before we accuse Jesus of not giving proper honor and deference to his mother, let's understand what he's saying. He is not saying that he has no natural mother. He's not denying the existence or even the importance of his mother. Instead, he's making the point that those who do the will of his Father have a deeper and closer relationship with him than any other earthly relationship, including his mother. Those who do the will of my Father, Jesus says, have a deeper and closer relationship with me than my own natural family. People often say blood is thicker than water. How many have heard that statement? Blood is thicker than water. If this is true, if the bond and the relationship that is formed by our blood relatives is strong, how much stronger are the bonds created by the blood of Jesus? Now listen. If we will admit that the relationship we have with those who share our same blood is strong, how much stronger should the bond be between those who share the blood of our Lord? Proverbs 18, turn over there. Proverbs 18. No, the relationship that are formed by the blood of Jesus is stronger than your blood relationships. His blood relationships are stronger. Proverbs 18:24. A man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer. Somebody say closer. Than a what? A blood relative. There it is. See, he's saying here, the writer of Proverbs saying, this is wisdom. That there are individuals, there are relationships, friendships that are closer than blood relatives. Oh my goodness. Is this not what Jesus is saying here? That the relationship I have with my disciples, even though I love my mother, even though I love my brethren, my family, my relationship with them is stronger than my natural family. The relationship we have with God and his people should be, somebody say should be, closer than any other relationship. Because, I want you to listen to me, because the individuals in the body of Christ, individuals, the fellow disciples, have a closer relationship because they not only share the same family, they share the same body. See, your natural family only shares, you, the only thing you haven't got is you all share the same family. But your spiritual family, your church family, you are part of the same body. The same body, not just the family, the same person. We are members of the body of Christ. Somebody say, that's closer. And I know some of you out there thinking, I hear you, Reverend, but I disagree. I disagree. I'm closer to my natural family than I am to church folk. Oh, see, but this is where you missed it. Jesus is not making a distinction between natural family and church people. He's making a distinction between our natural family and those who keep the commandments of God. Say different. Everybody in church isn't keeping the commandments of God. Jesus is not saying that everybody in I'm closer to everybody in church than I am with my own family. No. I'm not close with everybody in church because everybody in church don't do the will of God. But the people who do the will of God, there is a natural bond I have with them, and this bond is closer than my own family. If you're a disciple of Jesus, then you are naturally drawn to those who are also followers of Jesus. We're not talking about Christians here. We're talking about disciples. A disciple is a follower of Christ, one who does the will of God. And I'm saying there's a natural bond between people who have a mutual love for God and his word. When you find someone who shares your same love and commitment to God and his word, there is a natural bond that is formed between you two that cannot be compared even to a relationship of your own family. Matthew chapter 10, turn over there. I'm going to show you something. I'm going somewhere with this. I've got a point. I've got a point. Matthew chapter 10. Yeah, I'm going to fix some things today. Some things need to be fixed that's broken in our understanding. Look, I open service by honoring mamas. Now, I'm not saying mamas ain't important. Somebody say, but. Amen. That's where we need to do some examination is what happens after this. But Matthew chapter 10, verse 36. Again, Jesus' words. Again, his words. A man's foes, your greatest enemies, shall be they of your own household. Oh, so now, okay. Oh, somebody say, all right. He says, the biggest problem you're going to have in life is going to come from people in your own family. See, you pull your armor off when you go to family reunions. You need to keep it on. Because your biggest enemies is right there around the picnic table. Your biggest foes is going to be in your own house. Not my words, Jesus' words. What is he getting to? Well, we're going to get to it. Verse 37. He that loveth father. I mean, no, Father's Day is coming too. Okay. He that loveth father or mother more than me, it's not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me, it's not worthy of me. If you haven't guessed it, Jesus is here talking about our interpersonal relationships, not with mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers who are disciples, but mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers who are unsaved. I know. Listen. Because our mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers that are also followers of Christ fall into that unique relationship that we have a close bond with. We have a close bond with them not just because they're our family. We have a close bond with them because they are followers. But he's not talking about them. When he says mother, father, sister, brother, he's talking about mother, father, sister, brother that are not walking like you walk, that are not followers of Jesus Christ. Now, let me stop right here and point out to you one relationship he did not include in this list, and that's husband and wife. A reason, because in Christ's mind, a husband and wife is supposed to be one flesh. So there should be no conflict. Yeah, think about that. You know, a husband and wife should already be on the same page. But for many of us, unfortunately, our spouses fall into the father, mother, sister, brother category, people who are unsaved. But notice this, I want you to see. Notice what Jesus says here. He says, if you truly love God, if you're truly committed to him and following his word, then your love for him is going to naturally create antagonism, friction with people who are not saved, people who don't share your same commitment, people who don't share your same love, people who have a deep love for God and are committed to following his commandments, they naturally, without even trying, create friction in relationships with unsaved people. They got problems with you. They already have children who are unsaved, with parents who are loving God, serving God. It is always a problem. Why is there always friction between me and my child? Yeah, there it is. He's saying there is a natural friction. Like, why am I not close to my child? Why am I not close to my parents? You got to ask yourself, are you both followers of Christ? If not, expect antagonism. Expect friction. Why is that? Because it's the nature of love. I don't mean agape, and neither did Jesus. In Matthew chapter 10, the word love here is not the Greek word agape love. It's the Greek word phileo. Phileo. See, agape love is the love we use that we are supposed to operate in when we love all men, even our enemies, and pray for them. That's agape love. But Jesus is not talking about this. He's saying here in verse 37, he that phileos father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that phileos son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. That's phileo. You know what the word phileo is? Some of us are used to it or familiar with it. It's where we get the word Philadelphia. The city named Philadelphia is named from a translation of this word. And the word means a deep love and connection between people that shares the same interests. Somebody who is in a phileo relationship, who has a love relationship, a phileo relationship, is someone who has a shared interest with the other person. When you share the same interest with another person, there is a natural phileo or deep, somebody say deep, a deep connection between you and them. It's a connection between you and them. Find people who are alumni of your same university. Connection. Like, oh man, they're your best friend in the room. Like, oh, forget all of them. Go blue. Yes, we're buddies. The rest of them, go green. Get over there. Say connection. When we find individuals that share our interests, a bond is created immediately, because that's phileo. That's phileo. It's the reason why Abraham was called the friend of God. In James, Abraham is called the phileo. That's what the word friend there is translated from the word phileo. Abraham was the phileo of God because Abraham shared the same interest in God. When God commanded him to sacrifice his son, Abraham agreed. And through that, God understood that Abraham's heart was where his heart was. His heart wasn't more towards his family. His heart wasn't more towards the child he just received in his old age. His heart was still with God. And God was more important to him than any other relationship. And therefore, Abraham was called God's friend because he shared God's interests. But it says it's a big thing to be called a friend of God. That means you share his interests. Jesus told his disciples, you are my friends, phileo, if you do my commandments. See, if you share my interest, if you're doing what I'm doing, if you're on the same page with me, people that's not on the same page with God are not his friends. They do not have a deep, close relationship with God. They always want to, but they don't have that. If you have a deep connection with unsaved family and friends, then you're probably someone who wishes they had a deep, abiding relationship with God. Look at your friends. If you're super duper close, if your closest friends are unsaved relatives or individuals, you are probably someone who also secretly desires for a closer relationship with God. You just feel like I long for a deep connection with him. And people who have a deep, abiding connection, friendship with God, they're satisfied in their relationship with God, they probably rub their family the wrong way. They're probably individuals who are constantly being accused by their family of being disconnected and aloof. You don't love us like you love the church. You don't care nothing about us. You care more about this. You care more. I feel disconnected from you. Yeah, I'm telling you. You cannot have the phileo because you do not share the interest. So if you always wonder, why is there a disconnect between me and them? Check the interest. If it's different, the love will never be there. Remember this, write this down. Followers of Jesus are closest to other followers of Jesus. Followers of Jesus are closest to other followers of Jesus. And those who love the world are closest to other lovers of the world. Closest. I didn't say you don't have a relationship with people who are not saved or people who are saved. I'm saying your closest relationships are with people who share your interest. If you love God and will go all out for God, the closest people you have are people who will do the same. And if you won't go all out for God, you will never be close to people who will go all out for God. Never. You will never. You will always hit and miss. And most people don't understand this. As a result, they spend their time trying to fight for relationships that are unsustainable. So many people don't understand this, therefore they frustrate themselves trying to fight for relationships that are unsustainable. Because you don't share, you're looking for phileo that can only be created with a shared interest. That's the problem. Yes, you're kind. Yes, you're polite. Yes, you will attend dinners. Yes, you will attend get-togethers. Yes, you'll sit there and you'll play dominoes and you'll hang out and watch movies. But there is something always missing. There is something always missing, and that something is a shared, not the fact that you're not putting enough effort in it. See, we think that what's missing is a trip to Cabo. So let's all, we're going to all fly to Cabo, and Cabo is going to connect us. Cabo can't connect you. You're going to go all out to Cabo, and you won't be connected. You'll probably, get a good swim, get a tan. But you can't find connection because connection isn't found in a destination. It's found in shared interest. Or on the other hand, we'll spend our time feeling obligated to be close to unsaved family, trying to convince them to share our mutual love for God. How many times did that happen? We're trying to get family members to love us like the saints love us. There are some mamas out here that feel more like a mother from church people than they do their own family. And it keeps you up at night. And I'm saying, don't let it. Because Jesus didn't. Jesus didn't let. Did you not know his brothers couldn't stand him? Read the 7th chapter of John. The 7th chapter of John gives a little peek into the relationship Jesus' brothers had with him. They was like, oh, why don't you go down to Jerusalem? Because you want to be seen anyway. And Jesus had a little comeback. if you come with Jesus, he's going to come back at you. And he came back at his brother a little bit. He says, that's what you want. You're trying to put on me what you desire. That's what you want. But I do the will of my Father. He didn't care nothing about it. You didn't hear Jesus one time complain about how everybody in the world was following him except the people born in his own house. And he was the oldest brother. He probably babysat them while his mother and them went out for a date or whatever. He probably made them sandwiches. After everything I did for you, the whole world was following Jesus. Complete strangers and his own family, his brothers, rejected him. But Jesus didn't preach one sermon. You know, these brothers, he didn't preach one sermon on it. He didn't care nothing about it. Because he says, my real family is this. He understood that if you're wanting a part of this family, the family, the relationship I have with you is only temporary. But this is an eternal one. He didn't spend his time trying to be loved by people who didn't want him. He didn't spend his time. Jesus says, I pray for those whom you gave me. I pray not for the world, Meaning, I'm not spending my time chasing relationships, chasing love from people who don't share my interest. When God has given you a family right here. This is the importance of the church. The church is a support system to give you everything you lack. You lack kids treating you right? Come to church. You'll find some kids who will honor you like a real mother. You lack support and care from family members? Come to church. You'll find the support you're looking for. This is the family of God. Peter said, what do we receive? We've left everything. He says, not only will I give you houses, not only would I give you that, but I'll give you mothers and fathers and give you family. See, we don't always look at that. We're always asking God to give us a career instead of asking, Lord, give me a family. I'm giving you one right here. It's called the church. Find your value there. No, but we reject that. It's not enough for us. Too bad Jesus didn't share our same sentiment. It was enough for him. He says, this is my family and I love them. I don't know why we love folk that don't love us back. When the folk who want to love us is staring us right in our face and we reject them because they're not blood, at least not from our blood. They're from the Savior's blood. Oh, yeah, y'all don't like that. Mark chapter 3, yeah, you don't like it. I don't matter. It's madness. This is your family. Love them. See, this is our problem. God gives us stuff and we keep complaining about stuff we don't have, but we don't appreciate what we got right staring us in front of us. We're always wishing to have something else. See, God has met every need. Maybe not the way you wanted it. It's met. It's all in there. Eat it. Amen. Glory. Mark chapter 3, verse 19. So this is the story again we just read in Matthew. Here it is in Mark. Something else is added. That's why we're looking at Mark 3:19. Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him, and they went into a house, and the multitude cometh together again, so that they could not so much as what eat bread. So Jesus and his friends went to a house. They're in their house trying to eat. And it's like people found out Jesus was in the house and they just made that house a church. They just rushed in it and there was so many people in there, they couldn't eat. So Jesus started preaching. He started teaching a lesson. Yeah, okay, verse 21. And when his friends, really his family, his brothers and his mother, when his friends heard of it, they went out to what? Lay hold on him. For they said, he is what? He crazy. He lost his mind. He doing too merch. He merchy. Merchy. Jesus, you're being merchy. You're doing too merch over here. Notice where his friends, his family was not. Because when you read the rest of this passage later on, it talks about how your mother is out. This is the family, the friends. They found out Jesus was in his house, and he's supposed to be having lunch, and he done turned it into a church service. And they said, "Now that's too much." Now they could have went to he just had the service by the heel. Why can't they just go over there, have the service? Not a man trying to eat, and they won't even let him eat. And instead of rebuking him and saying, hey, I'm trying to eat, y'all leave, he just do whatever they say. Isn't that what our family say? You just do whatever that church asks you to do. On your own birthday, you at church. See, only sanctified folk get that. See, if you didn't grow up in a sanctified church, you know, when you have church all the time, you don't get this. But this is what they say to us, you know. Oh my God, there you go again on your own anniversary. It don't make no sense. Mama, you being too much. You're just too much. And they don't even get it. You love it. You're not doing it because you have to. You do it because you get to. You get more enjoyment out of that than sitting secretly with your own family. It's more of a chore. You got to get up for that. You got to get your mind together. Oh, got to go by mama's house. Got to get my mind right. 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 Got to get my mind. Oh, Jesus. And so his family, notice, I want you to say, if I say I'm listening, they come to the house and they say, tell Jesus to come on out of there. Come out the house. And when they were asking him out of the house, you know what they were also asking him to separate from? Separate from his duty and his commitment to doing God's will, and separate from the people who were eager to do God's will. Why? Why did they want him to do that? Because, as I said, they felt like he was being too much, beside himself. It's funny how the world always feels like we're doing too much when it relates to God. You gave $100 in church? That's too much. You do it too much. But they don't care nothing about taking $5,000 and putting it on invisible money, Bitcoin. That's good. Oh, Doc, you're going to be rich. Oh, God, you're going to be rich. That's not too much. I just took $5,000, put it on Bitcoin. Money, that's only money because somebody else told you. But when God say put it in the kingdom and he tell you it's going to multiply, oh, I don't believe that, but I believe this. I'm making fun, but I'm not making fun. Oh, we don't. Oh, that's too much. You're being merchy. How long was you over there at that church? 4 hours. Oh, my God. My God. 4 hours. What could you be doing for 4 hours? What is that? What is there to do for 4 hours? But they think nothing about working 6 days a week, 12-hour days. That's virtuous. I'm taking care of business. I'm being responsible. You never at home with your family. Somebody else is raising your kids. Somebody else is dating your wife. But you're being responsible. That's good. Yeah. Yeah. So how many of the world knows how to be merchy too? You see them on television. And the clothes they wear, you're like, that's just too much. No, that's in style. That's hot. I love it. I love it. I love it. Go ahead with your bad self. They come out with the, you see them on stages all over the place. And they're like, ooh, I love it. Girl, that's hot. And then they take pictures of church people with hats on. Look, she's just too much. They got the hat on. Why you got to do all that? Why you got to do that? See, it's always merch when you do it in church, but it's fashion when you do it in the world. What's the problem? Yeah, we know what the problem is. It's a disconnect. Our family and friends try to make us feel that we're doing them a favor. Or they try to make us feel like they're doing us a favor by keeping us out of church. Here, I'm sending you on vacation. I'm taking you away from this. I'm gonna do you a favor. But you know what they're really doing? They're really doing themselves a favor. And I'm about to hit it now. See, what they come to us and say is, I'm doing this for your own good because you're wearing yourself out. When secretly what they're saying is, you're wearing me out. You're convicting me. You're convicting me by you running after God. How much time you spend there. You're wearing my conscience out. And that's really, somebody say, I'm listening. That's really what Jesus was saying. Go to Luke chapter 8. I'm going to prove it to you. See, don't let people, especially your family, keep you from your commitment to God. See, that's what he's talking about. He says, you got to be careful about family, because they'll try to play that little trump card that they're trying to, you know, keep you from wearing yourself out. But what they're really doing is keeping you from obeying God and fulfilling your commitment, because you've been bought with a price and you don't belong to you. Oh, come on, somebody. See, the world wants to take that away from the church. They want to take that away from the church. They're trying to put all kind of guidelines and stipulations and protocol. Want to keep the church from doing time. I'm keeping you safe. No, you're keeping me from doing God's will. He says, be careful. I'm about to show you. All right. Because some of you still don't believe me. See, but to see this, you know, a lot of times this is staring us in the face, but to see this, I'm going to teach you a little Bible lesson here. To see this, you can't just look at the passage that you're studying. You got to look at the context. You got to look at the verses that come before and after to get the full impact of what Jesus is saying. So we're going to go to Luke chapter 8. And again, this is the place where this same story is repeated for us. It's repeated for us in verses 19 to 21. Of him and his mother, you know, calling him out. But we're going to jump back to verse 16. Luke 8, 16. Here's the context. Jesus says, no man, when he hath lighted a candle, covers it with a vessel, or putteth it under a bed, but setteth it on a candlestick, that they which enter in may what? See the light. Jesus is here warning his disciples of covering their light. Covering their light. What does he mean? What does it mean to cover a candle? What's a candle? Go with me to Proverbs chapter 20. Proverbs chapter 20. What's the candle? We're coming back to Luke 8, but go to Proverbs 20. What does he mean by lighting a candle? What's the candle? Well, here in Proverbs 20, it's going to tell us what the candle represents. Verse 27, the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. So the human spirit represents the candle. And to light a candle means to bring illumination, understanding, truth into your spirit. And when Jesus says no man lights a candle to cover it, he says God doesn't give you truth. He doesn't reveal his truth to you, lights your spirit, illuminates, turn the light on, in other words, for you to hide and conceal the fact that you know the truth. Instead, what he expects to happen is when he reaches into you and turns on your light, helps you to see truth that you've been ignoring, he expects you not to cover it, but to take that light and put it on a candlestick. That is to display that light, to let it shine. And you do that by proclaiming what you know and by walking in what you know. That's how you let your light shine. You let your light shine by speaking what's been revealed to you and doing what's been revealed to you. You're letting your light shine. And anytime you receive revelation from God, but you do not speak it, you do not proclaim it, and you do not perform it, then you're covering your own light. This is what he's saying here. Now notice, why is it that people cover their light? More important, what does covering my light have to do with this incident of Jesus's mother and brothers trying to call him out the house? See, that's the question we need to be asking. Jesus talks about not hiding your light, and then he talks about this incident between his mother and his family. Why are they related? Because, somebody say, I'm listening. Sometimes the ones who are the biggest cause of us covering our light is our own family. Our own family. See, Jesus received light from his Father to do his will. He said, it is my meat to do the will of my Father. I must work while it is light or day. The night cometh and no man can what? I've received an assignment. You want to know why Jesus had urgency? He was going from here to there. He had an assignment. Guess what his family tried to get them to do? Turn it down some. That's what our family always want us to do. Dim it down some. Come down a little bit, Reverend. Come on down some. And why do they want to do that? I'll tell you why. John chapter 3. Here's why. Here's why. Why do they want us to dim our light? See, they want to put a dimmer switch on it. Anybody have a dimmer switch, you know? Dimmer switch allows you to have a light without it being effective. You know, just give you a semblance of having a light, but you can't really see nothing. Dim it down. Dim it down. Here, why do they want to dim the light? John chapter 3, verse 19. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world. And men, here it is again, loved darkness rather than light. Why don't they love the light? Because their deeds are evil. For everyone that doeth evil hates aversion. I told you, natural aversion to truth hates the light. Neither cometh to the light. Why? Lest his deeds be reproved. See, you're wearing me out. You're showing me up. Every time I see you praying, you're reminding me, why am I not praying? Every time I see you in a word, you're reminding me, why am I not in the words? But instead of me repenting and humbling myself and doing what God, what you're helping me to see what God has already told me, I get mad at you until you turn your light out. Verse 21, but he that doeth the truth cometh what? They're coming in the house. That his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. See, people who love the truth love seeing people who do the truth. Oh, I love that. Amen. People who don't love the truth, she thinks she's something. She always trying to show off. See? Those are people who don't love the truth. She got something up her sleeve. See? They don't love the truth. That's why they got a problem with it. It's like when you walk into a room that's totally dark, and you turn the light on, everybody in that room is going to get mad at you. I don't care what relationship you have with them. They can be your child, your mama, your husband. If you turn the light on in a room where people have been sitting in darkness for a while, they're going to attack you. They're going to attack you. They're going to tell you, turn that light, pressure you. And that's exactly what we do every time we show up at the picnic. It's like light coming in. And they can't wait till we go so they can turn it up. Yeah, they can't wait till they can turn it up. Because they want to go back. They want to go to Romans chapter 1. See, because when the light comes, you got no more excuses. See, we like darkness. You want to know why we darkness? Because we can say, ooh, I didn't know what. Is there alcohol in that? Ooh, I didn't know that. We love to say, oh, who is this? You ain't my wife. What are you doing laying next to me? Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, is this a knife in my hand? Oh, did I do that? I didn't know I did that. I plead that I was insane. I didn't know. See, as long as we don't know, we have an excuse for the things we do. But the moment we see the truth, now people will hold us accountable. That's what we hate. Here, Romans chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. See, the light came on, for God showed it to them. For the invisible things of him from creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are what? Without what? That's what light causes. It takes away all excuses. This is why people don't like to really go deep with God and study their word and go all out in their commitment to God, because they know that if they keep going to church, they're going to keep seeing more. They keep seeing more, they're going to be required to do more. They don't want to do that. Because now, once they see it, they're without excuse. They're without excuse. How many know truth takes away our excuses? And so what we tend to do when we have the truth, we try to conceal it. Or as it says in verse 18, hold the truth in unrighteousness. I'm going to show you that verse 18, Romans 1:18 in the Good News Bible. Notice what it says here. He says, God's anger is revealed from heaven against all the sin and evil of the people whose evil ways prevent the truth from being known. See, they don't want it to be known. And they don't want you to keep proclaiming it. And so your family, you must be careful, because they will try to quench or throw shade on your light, to tone it down. And this is what is happening in our society. Either they are trying to prevent the truth from coming out, or they do as verse 25 says. Look at Romans 1:25. He says, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Notice, if it's not enough for them to pervert the truth, what are they trying to do? Change it. Change it. Like they do today. Now, when it comes to COVID, they say follow the science. But when it comes to gender identity, they change that. You never hear them say the science, because the science says you can't, if you're a boy, you can't be a girl. You can't. It's biologically impossible. Why you never hear them say follow the science? Never say follow the science on gender identity. Never. The pandemic followed the science, but not with this. See, because they want to change it. They want to change the truth. Why? Because they're being convicted. And he also says in verse 25, why they change the truth and why they're perverting the truth. Because they love the creature. They got more phileo of people, relationships, than they do of the creator. There it is right there. When you love people more than God, you're going to change the truth. You're going to say like they say, it don't take all that. You're going to say like they say, that wasn't really required. You're going to say what they say, God don't really need me to do that. He's not really requiring me to do that. You know why we do this? Because we love creatures more than the creator. We love family more than the word. You see where our love needs to be? It needs to be with God. Yeah. And this is Jesus's point. And his mothers and brothers were coming to him to call him out of the house. They were demonstrating a principle, namely how earthly relationships try to tempt us to cover our light, to cover our light. And if we have a greater affinity for them than we do for God, we will comply to their pressure. So you know what it is? It's a test. It's a test. Jesus was being tested by his mother and his brother. See, many of us pass a test when the test comes from the hand of the devil or the neighbor or the person on the job, but we're failing the test when it comes from the hand of our own family. Do you know your family will test you? Oh, I need somebody to listen to me. I said, our family is testing us. They're testing us. They're pressuring and pushing us to comply to their beliefs because when we stand in a light, it makes them feel uncomfortable. And God's testing, he wants to see what we're going to do. And many of us are not passing. Why? Because we still want to be called mama. The greatest mama ever. You better be careful. Saints, I say we better be careful. We're fighting for love of people rather than fighting to sustain the love that God has for us. We should be fighting to stay in his love. I said we should be fighting to stay in his love. Yep, we don't. But here's the danger. Go back to Luke chapter 8. If we pacify our family and friends and conceal our light, we're going to lose our place in the family of God. See, you're fighting to stay in a relationship and in a family, and you're going to lose your place in the kingdom of God. Not only that, you're going to lose your ability to see light. Here in Luke 8:18, he says, "Take heed how you hear, for whosoever hath, to him shall be given. And whosoever hath not, for him shall be taken even that which he seen." What does he mean, whosoever hath? Well, he just talked about having your light shine. So if God comes by and see that your light is not on after he's given you light, he's going to take your light from you. And he's going to take from you the ability to see light. But what makes him eager, what makes him desirous to give you more light is when he comes by you and he sees something that you've done with the truth he's given you. You're proclaiming it or you're walking it. That's how you get more. See, people always wonder, how do I get a deeper relationship with God? How do I get revelation? I want to know God. You don't know God by having the right teachers. You know how you know God? For having the right obedience. He gives revelation. He gives knowledge to people who do the word. We're wondering why our relationship with God keeps sputtering. It's because we're not giving it our attention. We're not doing when he reveals truth, like in settings like this, when he shows us revelation. Many of us do not then leave places like this and then start walking in it and standing on it. We let our family cower us down. And to pacify them, we conceal and hide what we know to be the truth. When we ought to be saying, and here's the day, it's going to be a great opportunity. I guarantee you, your family, if they meet with you, they're going to probably say or do something stupid that you know ain't right. And it's going to be a challenge. And you're going to say, amen. No, praise God, that's not right. That's right. Somebody said, take a stand. And we don't do that. We'll stand up for our natural family. What you say about my mother? What you say about my sister? But we never say, what you say about the word? What you say about my God? Because we care more about sustaining those relationships than we do about letting our light shine. And God says, don't worry. You have another family who loves your light. Who appreciates your light. And when my mother and father forsake me. Oh, come on, somebody. When my sister and brother forsake me. When my friends forsake me. Then the who? Then the Lord. What is he going to do? Here, come home with me. I got a family for you. He says, I will not leave you orphans. If they abandon you, I won't leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. And I want to end this by saying today, I find it funny how Jesus' relatives were urging him to come out of the house to meet with them rather than going into the house to meet with him. They wanted him to come out of the house to meet with them, but they would not come into his house to meet with him. If you're on the outside and your family member is on the inside, today is as good a day as ever to come in the house and join them. That's what I want you to know. Rather than requiring your loved one to come out of the house, why don't you take the opportunity starting today to come in the house? To join them in the house. Meet with them there. When I was a child, my dad, he was an avid fisherman, loved to fish. I remember coming home from school. I was a young boy. And he was going fishing. And I would always ask him, "Dad, can I go fishing with you?" It wasn't so much that I cared about the fishing as I cared about being in relationship with him. And there are so many of us, we see our loved ones going fishing for souls. And rather than joining them in the boat, we go in a basement, play video games, or do whatever. And we're missing out on a rewarding relationship. Don't stand on the outside. Come in the house. Come in the house. There's room. There's room right now. I want to pray for you. Bow your heads with me today. I'm praying for someone out there today who desires to have that deep and abiding connection with God, or that deep abiding affection, connection with one of God's children, maybe a parent, maybe a sibling, maybe a spouse. I invite you to come into the family of God. Come in the house. Submit yourselves and surrender your hearts to the Lord. Allow him to enter into your house, to your heart. And I guarantee you, you will find the love that you're desperately seeking. You'll find that connection when you share that interest. If you don't have it, ask him to put it in your heart. Say, "Lord, put a desire for your word, a love for your word in my heart. Cause me, Lord, to share the same interest, the same love as you have, that I might be called the friend of God." Father, I pray now that you would grant grace to many that are listening to me today. Finally, I pray for those who are in the house that they won't cover their light. That they will let no thing and no man cause them to conceal what you have brought to light, what you have revealed to them. Give us the courage, Lord. Give your people courage to proclaim and stand up for the truth. Not to be arrogant, not to be prideful, but not to be ashamed. As the Apostle Paul says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God to salvation." I thank you for this word. Let it sink down deep in our hearts. Let it forever change us. In Jesus' name, amen. Give me what to say.
Let me hear you. Thank you for listening. If this teaching has been a blessing to you and you'd like to partner with our ministry to share the message of Jesus Christ, please visit our website at www.hmclive.org and click the donate button. If you're in our area, we invite you to join us at 4317 Lippincott Boulevard, Burton, Michigan, 48519. Harris Memorial Church of God in Christ, teaching the truth, and showing the love.